Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Pastor Vern Christofferson, interim pastor here at Good Shepherd. Welcome to worship this morning. This is the fifth Sunday of the month, and we've decided that we're going to celebrate communion on the fifth Sunday, especially since so many of our schedules are unpredictable these days. So if you happen to be streaming, know that meal is coming, and we encourage you to get some bread and wine, some juice and crackers, and join us for this time. A few announcements to share, mostly about upcoming events. On July 14th, we hope to do a blessing and send-off for our New Orleans youth gathering people. So that's July 14th. On July 21st, we're planning a recognition or retirement party for Gene Carlson that day. That will be after worship. And then during July and August, we're going to have a sermon series on the book of Psalms, Psalms for Sojourners. So if you've got some favorite translations or paraphrases of the Psalms, I encourage you to get to reading on them. We won't be able to cover all 150 of those Psalms, but hopefully you will find that sermon series to be helpful and engaging. We begin our worship with a prayer. In difficult times, I encourage you to stand. Consoling God, be a source of serenity for me. God of hope, assure me of your unconditional love. Compassionate God, hold me to your heart.
When I feel
comforting God, shelter me under your wings.
When I am involved in sadness and
God of peace, you are the center of my life, a strong refuge of peace in the whirlwind of my pain.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. The Lord be with you. Almighty and merciful God, we implore you to hear the prayers of your people. Be our strong defense against all harm and danger, that we may live and grow in hope, faith and hope, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
This morning's reading is from Lamentations, chapter 3, verses 22 to 33. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait patiently, one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for one to bear the yoke in youth, to sit alone in silence when the Lord has imposed it, to put one's mouth to the dust, there may yet be hope, to give one's cheek to the smiter and be filled with insults. For the Lord will not reject forever. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love, for he does not willingly afflict or grieve anyone. Holy wisdom, holy word.
I'm not sure we have enough kiddos today. So, if I'm missing someone, I apologize, but why don't we go on with our gospel acclamation? I would invite you to stand.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him, and a large crowd followed him and impressed upon him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." And immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately, aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you, and how can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." And while he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people wailing and weeping loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. And then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him, and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. And at this they were overcome with amazement. And he strictly ordered them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Please join me in a prayer. Good and gracious God, there are so many needs in our world and in our lives. Speak to us when and where we need you most. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Time for a survey. And I'm taking this survey because I want to find out if you're the kind of folks who've got your act all together. Okay? Ready? How many of you get regular checkups from the doctor? Raise your hand. Okay, I see a number of you, and the dentist. Okay, you're not doing too bad so far. How many of you can hook up your own internet service at home and don't need help from your children or grandchildren? Okay, that's fewer. And how many of you have no trouble getting everything on your to-do list done? Okay, we're not doing so well there, and neither am I. I've got news for you. This week's gospel reading is perfect for the people out there who don't have their acts all together. Now, we know what you're thinking. That means all of us, right? Well, sure, except we're not always ready to admit it, are we? I mean, what happens to us when things fall apart for a while? Researcher Brené Brown writes that one of the hardest things for us to do is be vulnerable, to come across like we don't have it all together. As you well know, we've been drenched in rain over the past couple of months in many parts of Minnesota and the upper Midwest. Some of the crops didn't even get planted, and of those that did, large portions are underwater. My heart goes out to those of you who are farmers and to your families. You're bound to feel helpless at a time like this. And speaking of helpless, the Blue Earth River has been crashing toward the Rapidan Dam outside of Mankato. It's made the national news. We've watched as the churning water washed away more and more of the land holding up the little white house on the bank of the river. And then one day, the house tumbled into the river and suddenly it was gone. And this week, the Rapidan Dam store a mile away had to be emptied out and torn down. And for the Riska family, longtime owners of the house and the store, it was bound to be a helpless feeling, just as it's been for the farmers. We've been following several stories of flooding throughout the area. Kirsten Wagner's parents, Clay and Sharon Miller, live in Waterville. As the floodwaters rose, they moved the food and dishes higher and higher and higher in their cupboards. And then the water and the power went out, and the refrigerator was floating. They needed to leave. Oh, they've been able to get back a few times to check on things, but they have to take back roads to get there, and then wade through 2 to 3 feet of floodwater. Despite the mess, Clay and Sharon are profoundly grateful for the hundreds of volunteers that came to fill sandbags in an effort to save their little town. And they're also grateful for their another daughter, Pammy, who has room for them to stay in nearby Faribault. There's a common theme in these flood stories, a feeling of helplessness and desperation. And in this regard, they're not so different from the folks who reach out to Jesus in our gospel for today. Each has a story to tell. Each is desperate, and they clearly don't have it all together. Jairus is the leader of the synagogue. He comes to Jesus asking for help. Not all Jewish leaders were open to Jesus, of course, but evidently Jairus was. Leaders are trained to be competent, to get things done, to have it all together. That fits until your 12-year-old girl gets sick, really sick, maybe even to the point of death. We can understand why Jairus himself runs to Jesus instead of sending someone. We can understand why he throws himself at Jesus' feet rather than look him in the eye. And we can understand why he doesn't ask politely, but rather begs for Jesus to come home with him. Jairus is desperate. His love for his daughter has left him utterly helpless and vulnerable. Brenda and I have a daughter named Ingrid. Ingrid had her first grand mal seizure about the age of Jairus' daughter. We didn't see it coming. It scared us half to death. And later, the doctors had a name for it, juvenile onset epilepsy. Or whatever it's called, it's scary when our kids get sick, so very scary. Like Jairus, Brenda and I were willing to do just about anything to protect Ingrid and get her well. The unnamed woman in our gospel is pretty much the exact opposite of Jairus. She has no social standing. There's no one to go to the teacher on her behalf. And if that's not bad enough, she's been bleeding for 12 years. Mark doesn't emphasize the bleeding. But according to Jewish law, it would have rendered her unclean, and she would have been cut off from her community. Equally troubling, it probably would have kept her from having children, someone to look after her in her infirmity. The woman quietly sneaks through the crowd, seeking merely to touch the cloak of this healer that everyone's been talking about. She's desperate. She's hoping against hope for an end to her illness, whatever it takes to get well. Lots and lots of people have been coming to Jesus. He's swamped. Each in their own way is desperate. Each is helpless and vulnerable. One thing seems abundantly clear. They've given up any need to have it all together, or at least to pretend as much. No, they come to Jesus exactly as they are, broken and desperately in need of healing and hope. So what do we do with stories like these? I have a couple of ideas. First, we can try to change the way we think about vulnerability, our vulnerability. Again, Brené Brown is helpful. When things go wrong, she says, we often end up feeling exposed and desperate. If such is the case for us, Brown nudges us toward open and honest vulnerability, much like those stories in Mark. Only by admitting our vulnerability, says Brown, are we able to find the courage we need to act differently. Who knows? Maybe admitting our need won't be the end of the world, just the end of the world we've so carefully constructed. And if we're able to leave behind that carefully constructed world, and this is important, we may be able to accept ourselves and others as simply good enough. Let me say that again. If we're able to leave behind that carefully constructed world, we may be able to accept ourselves and others as good enough. We may enter a new world of acceptance and mutual regard that is profoundly different than so much of the world around us. Jesus has a name for this world. It's called the Kingdom of God. And at the heart of it is God's steadfast love and faithfulness. A second thing we can try: to work at being a community of faith where people don't have to have it all together. This can be hard, perhaps especially in a small town church like Good Shepherd, where so many people know so much about you, or at least think they do. Lots of churches say everyone is welcome. Come just as you are. But I'm not convinced they mean it. Sometimes those churches are referring to shorts and blue jeans instead of suits, ties, and dresses. But what if we take that a step further? What if we pledge to be a community that genuinely accepts people with all sorts of differences, that genuinely a community that works to restore the broken to life, a community that accepts limitations and honors vulnerability and feelings of helplessness? How different would that feel? How welcoming and supported would we become? I mean, how many people are desperate for a word of acceptance and love from us, for a word that says, you are good enough, just the way you are. Friends, what do people need from us? Probably a whole lot of acceptance and love. Our hardworking quilters recently sent a number of quilts to Lutheran World Relief. They soon received a warm thank you from the president of LWR. He acknowledged the care that goes into making these comforting gifts of love. Then the president told the story of a woman in Ukraine who received one such quilt last winter. Her name is Natalia Chernenka. She's an elderly woman. She said that the comfort of the quilt meant so much to her, especially because her house has been damaged by a missile and it was so very cold on so many nights. It's an incredibly touching letter. You can read the full version in the July The Voice. Friends, today's gospel is about healings, but it's about more than that. It's a lifeline for those of us who are sometimes helpless and who don't have it all together. That's what the folks like. That would be like folks, the rain-soaked farmers, the Ruskas in the Rapidan Dam, and Clay and Sharon Miller in Waterville. Folks like Jairus and the bleeding woman and Jairus' daughter. Folks like Natalia Chernenka. And folks like you and me. To be honest, I don't expect Jesus, as caring as he is, to stop every storm, to heal every disease, and to raise the dead like he did for Jairus' daughter. But I do believe this. When we go to Jesus with our desperation and helplessness, he will not leave us exactly as he finds us. No, broken people will be cared for and restored to life. And that is good news indeed. Amen.
Of our every ill, my God.
One in the communion of saints and in the power of the Holy Spirit, we join our voices in prayer. God of acceptance, sustain those among us who don't feel valued. Open our hearts to proclaim that all are good enough, and you have come to restore the broken to life. In your mercy, hear our prayer. God of protection, watch over those suffering water damage from recent floods. Send days of sunshine. Give us strong backs and open hearts and all the patience we might need. In your mercy, God of compassion, your touch brings healing and life. Hear our prayers for Jim Proust, Deb Larson, Suzanne Martin, Joyce Larson, Deb Wilner, Carolyn Schuyler, Noah Todd, and those we name in our hearts. Also, we give thanks for doctors, nurses, and healthcare workers who bring healing to us in so many ways. In your mercy, God of our nation, we are grateful for the United States of America and for the freedoms we enjoy. As we celebrate July 4th, make us mindful of all that is ours and help us bring healing to our troubled world. In your mercy, Holy God, holy and merciful, into your outstretched arms we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in the one who is the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. I invite you to take a moment and share a sign of peace with those nearby. As we get ready to receive our offering, a moment of thanks. We've been collecting funds, as you know, for the tuck pointing project and the bell tower. And to date, we have had you donate $16,675. It's a great amount, it's well towards our goal, I think, of a $22,000 or so. Is that what it was, Bill? Well, whatever you just said, yeah, that's what it is, okay. But yeah, we're well on the way. We're getting close. Thank you so much for your giving. It makes a difference. Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, and it's given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, our Lord Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it and remember me." Lord, remember us when you come into your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ has set the table with more than enough for all. Come. You may be seated. Certainly all are welcome at this table. I hope you would feel free to join us. We will serve communion at stations. We'll start on the lectern side and then go to the pulpit side. Just a reminder that as you come forward, there's a gluten-free wafer if you need one and would prefer that. There's also, we encourage you, cups that will be filled. First in the row will be grape juice, and the next will come with wine. Know that you are welcome here. If you're not able to come to the front, tell the server, and we will be glad to bring it to you in the pew. All things are made ready. Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen. The blessing of God, who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace. You are the body of Christ.